Welcome to Through the Bible with Les Felding, a 30-minute walk through the Scriptures, teaching in-depth Bible truths that change people's lives. Now, here's your host, Les Felding.
I hope you had time to finish your coffee. We kind of cut this break a little short so we can stay on schedule for the afternoon. For those of you joining us on television, again, we just want to welcome you. And again, we appreciate when people tell us they feel like they're sitting on the back row. And I think I mentioned in the first program that a couple from Canada would be asked us to make sure and mention that even though they're up in Canada, they're sitting back there on the back row and studying with us. So we do. We appreciate all your letters and your prayers, your financial help. And when we go on these seminars, how we appreciate hearing what the Lord has been doing in so many lives. Okay, if you want anything pertaining to today's program, we're in book number 50, and the others, of course, are really moot for that. So anyway, if you want some part of this program, just call and tell us you're interested in book number 50. Remember that every book is a compilation of 12 successive programs, so it takes 3 months to get ready for a new book. All right, back to where we left off. We were in Hebrews chapter 9, and again, we're just simply trying to show that everything that went before was God-ordained, and even though it wasn't perfect from man's side, it was from God, but man, of course, being the flesh that he is, it had no power, and consequently, it was weak and beggarly, as Paul calls it in Galatians. And now, as we saw in our last program then, that everything back there in the tabernacle was a preview of the finished work of the cross, and how even the materials in the Ark of the Covenant all spoke of his death, his burial, his resurrection, and the Word of God being the very manna that would sustain us for this age of grace. All right, now let's just go on. I think Chuck is doing the numbers today, and we're going to be in Hebrews 9. We're going to start verse 6 in this half hour and just continue on. All right, now when these things were thus ordained, that is, the furnishings in the tabernacle, all the way from the brazen altar to the laver of cleansing to the table of showbread to the candlestick and the altar of incense, and then behind the veil was the Ark of the Covenant, in which were the three things we just spoke of. All right, so now then, when all these things were thus ordained, that is, of God himself, the priests of Israel, all Levites, remember, went always into the first tabernacle, accomplishing the service of God, but into the second went the high priest alone once every year. All right, let me come back to my diagram. So daily, the priests would begin with the animal sacrifices out here at the brazen altar. They would stop at the laver of cleansing and wash and wash and wash. And then they would come on in, and of course they would replace the loaves of bread on the table of showbread. And they would trim the wicks and fill the oil and all that in the candlestick. They would trim the fires and everything on this altar of incense, but never beyond the veil. And then they would accomplish their daily work and go back out. Now that's as far as they could go in their daily ministration, but once a year, we were just talking at break, and I've never been able to discern from Scripture, did he come around the end of the veil, or was it split? But whatever, he didn't go under it, but somehow or other, once a year, the high priest would come in behind the veil and sprinkle the blood upon the mercy seat, and then go back out, get the blood of another animal, come back in for the sins of Israel, go back out. And only once a year on what we call the Day of Atonement. Now remember, the Day of Atonement could not take away Israel's sin. It was only a stopgap. It was a covering. And that's why David says so clearly in the Psalms, blessed is the man whose sins are what? Covered. They weren't atoned for completely. They couldn't be with animals' blood. And so that's why, too. I guess maybe I wasn't planning to do this. Maybe I better do it again. So few people understand this whole concept of the departure of the Jewish believers or unbelievers, as far as that goes, in the Old Testament economy. And the scripture is so plain that they went down into Hades, or Sheol, or hell as we call it in the English. But Hades was divided by a great gulf, and on one side were the flames of torment, and on the other side was paradise. But it was all down in the center part of the earth. Now maybe we better chase down the scriptures. It's been a long time since we've done this. Didn't plan to, so forgive me if I don't find these as fast as I would have if I'd have practiced a little bit. But come back with me to Matthew chapter 12. Matthew chapter 12. I think it behooves us to review some of these things that we haven't covered in a long, long time. Back in Matthew chapter 12, in Christ's earthly ministry, starting in verse 38, Matthew 12, verse 38. Matthew 12, 38. Then certain of the scribes and the Pharisees answered, saying, Master, we would see a sign from thee. Now you remember the Jews were always requiring a sign. Now verse 39, and if you got a red letter edition, it'll be in red. And he answered and said, An evil and an adulterous generation seeketh after a sign. There shall no sign be given to it, but the sign of the prophet Jonah. Now, if you ever have somebody scorn the story of Jonah, then you just tell them, well, the creator of the whole universe believed it. And if the creator himself believed it, you better. Because if you don't, you're going to stand in danger of the judgment someday, because if you can't believe that, then you can't believe the work of the cross. That's the way I look at it. Because one is just as believable as the other. And so here the Lord of glory himself is putting his stamp of affirmation on the story of Jonah. All right? And he says, except for the sign of the prophet Jonah, for, verse 40, as Jonah was 3 days and three nights in the whale's belly, so shall the Son of Man be 3 days and three nights in the, what? Heart of the earth, which means the very center. In the heart of the earth. All right, now let's go up and get a little glimpse of that place in the center of the earth in Luke, I think it's chapter 16, Luke chapter 16, and we can jump in at verse 19. And again, I think we'll just take the time to read a good portion of this, because the Word of God is more powerful than any two-edged sword. And it's certainly more powerful than anything I can say, so we'll just let it speak for itself. Luke 16, verse 19, and again, in the words of the Lord Jesus himself. Now, I can never emphasize enough that even though he was on earth in the flesh, he never stopped being the Creator God of Genesis 1:1. And of course, this is what Hebrews has been showing, that Christ was totally God in the flesh. All right, so as God, you see, he knows exactly what he's talking about. And this is not a parable. Doesn't say that it is. There was a certain rich man, verse 19, who was clothed in purple and fine linen and fared sumptuously every day. In other words, he was really rich. And there was a certain beggar named Lazarus who was laid at his gate full of sores, and desiring to be fed with the crumbs which fell from the rich man's table. Moreover, the dogs came and licked his sores. The poor guy was in tough shape materially. Verse 22, and it came to pass that the beggar died. A believer. because he's carried by the angels into Abraham's bosom. Now you want to remember, Abraham is 2,000 years before Christ. And so the angels carry this beggar's soul into Abraham's bosom. The rich man also died, was buried, but his soul is in hell. In hell, he lifted up his eyes. Now, in the same center of the earth, of course, but he is not on the paradise side, he's on the torment side. And so in hell, this place of the departed, down here in the center of the earth, as Jesus said in Matthew 12, he's in torment. Abraham and Lazarus are over here on the paradise side. All right, so the rich man, being in torment, seeth Abraham afar off and Lazarus in his bosom. And he, the rich man, cried and said, Father Abraham, have mercy on me and send Lazarus, that he may dip the tip of his finger in water and cool my tongue, for I am tormented in this flame. But Abraham said, Son, so evidently this rich man was a Jew, Son, remember that thou in thy lifetime received the good things, and likewise Lazarus the evil. But now he is comforted, and thou art tormented. Now here it comes. Verse 26, beside all this, Jesus explains it, between us, Abraham tells the rich man, between us and you there is a great gulf fixed. No bridges across it, no way across, so that they who would pass from here to you cannot. Lazarus can't come over and help you. Neither can they pass to us. You can't come over here. So then verse 27, he said, the rich man does, I pray thee therefore, Father, that is, Father Abraham, that thou would send him to my father's house, my kinsman, still alive up there in Israel. Send him to my father's house, for I have five brethren, that he may testify unto them, lest they also come into this place of torment. Now, you know what that tells me? Every lost human being, the moment they depart this life, they wish they could have somebody go back and tell their loved ones, don't come here. But it's impossible, see? All right, and this is no different. Now remember, this is not a parable. I have to feel that Jesus is giving us a little window of information that is as true as truth can be. So the rich man says, send that Lazarus, that they can be warned that they not come to this place of torment. Now verse 29, but Abraham said unto him, they have Moses and the prophets. What does that mean? They've got the word of God. Now today, you see, when lost people immediately find themselves in that place of torment, and if they could scream, send somebody to warn my loved ones, what would still be the same answer? They have the word of God. Only God would probably narrow it down a little more, and he'd say, they have Paul's epistles. You remember what I'm always showing from Peter? Peter says that if you would have salvation, you go to the epistles of Paul, for according to the wisdom given unto him. That's what they would tell us. You go to Paul's epistles if you want to find salvation. All right, but now let's go a little further. Verse 30, and he said, nay, Father Abraham, but if one went unto them from the dead, they will repent. Oh, if somebody could just tell them what it's like down here, they would believe. No, they won't. No, they won't. Look at the next verse. 31, and he said unto him, if they hear not Moses and the prophets. Now remember, this is an Old Testament economy. If they won't listen to Moses and the prophets, neither will they be persuaded, though one rose from the dead. What does God know? The human mindset. And it's no different today. My, sometimes I guess we wonder, if only God could just sort of manifest himself in some tremendous way, people would believe. No, they won't. No, they won't. Someone wrote me the other day, and they said, Les, I'm beginning to realize that more and more as I hear you teach that if Christ would come today, the world would crucify him again. And I'm afraid that's true, because the vast majority want nothing to do with these things. All right, so now we can establish that in the Old Testament economy, before the blood of Christ was shed, since animal blood could not take away the sin of even the greatest believer, such as Moses and Abraham, they went down into the center of the earth, into the paradise side of Sheol. But when the blood was shed and the work of the cross was finished, now let's pick up and see what Paul teaches in Ephesians. And it all falls in place again so perfectly, so clearly. Ephesians chapter 4, verse 8 and 9 and 10. Ephesians 4, 8, 9, and 10. Give you time to find it, because you got to read this with your own eyes, otherwise it won't sink in. Now remember the setting. All the Old Testament believers have been going down into paradise, only in the realm of soul and spirit, of course, fully conscious. But when Christ says to the thief on the cross, and I don't think I have to have you read that one. You all know what he said. What did he say? Today, thou shalt be with me where? In paradise. Not up in heaven. In paradise. All right, now Paul puts the frosting on the cake. Ephesians 4, verse 8. Wherefore he saith, that is Christ in verse 7. Wherefore he saith, when he ascended up on high, he led captivity captive. In other words, he took those that were in captivity and removed them. Now, who were the ones in captivity? These Old Testament believers waiting for the atoning blood. I guess I'm pointing up here. Maybe I should put it up. They're waiting for the work of the cross. They're waiting for Christ to come down in those 3 days and three nights and declare unto them, as Peter puts it in his epistle, he preached unto them, what? That the atoning blood was now shed, and that he could take them out, and now they could go into the heavenlies in the presence of God, because of Christ's blood, their sins were totally removed. Now, I was just talking to somebody on the phone again the other evening. When I maintain that at salvation, that we are forgiven, and God has sent our sins far, far away. I think the psalmist puts it as into the depths of the deepest sea, doesn't he? Never to be remembered against us anymore. Well, you see, when that happens and you and I are so cleansed by the blood of Christ, now we have no compunction with saying, as Paul does, absent from the body is where? Present with the Lord. He doesn't hold our past against us. He's forgotten it. It's gone. And we are now fit to go into his presence. But the Old Testament saints were only under the blood of animals. It was just a stopgap, as I've been saying over and over all afternoon. It was just a covering waiting for the finished work of the cross. All right, now let's read on in Ephesians. So when he ascended up on high, he led captivity captive, gave gifts unto men. Now verse 9. Now that he ascended, what is it but that he also first, what? Descended into the lower parts of the earth. See how that fits with Matthew 12? Now then, verse 10. He that descended, the Christ of the cross, he that descended is the same also that ascended up far above all the heavens, that he might fill or fulfill all things. Now see how plain that is? You don't have to be a seminary graduate to understand that. You don't have to be a PhD in English. It's just plain as day. That as Jonah was 3 days in the belly of the fish for 3 days and three nights, so must the Son of Man be in the heart of the earth 3 days and three nights. What is it but that he descended first into the lower parts of the earth, took captive all these Old Testament believers and took them up to paradise, which is now in heaven. And torment, of course, now is enlarged according to the Old Testament prophets. And now torment, of course, covers the whole area because paradise is now in glory. Well, now let's come back to Hebrews. See if we can make some more sense out of this. Back to Hebrews chapter 9. Verse 7 again, but into the second, that is beyond the veil, back into that Holy of Holies, where the Ark of the Covenant was placed. Into that Holy of Holies went the high priest alone, once a year, never without blood, animal blood, which he offered for himself. And then he'd have to go back out and kill the second animal, take its blood, and again go behind the veil, and that was for the people. Now verse 8. The Holy Spirit, this signifying or showing that the way into the holiest of all, that is into the very presence of God, was not yet made manifest, while as the first tabernacle was yet standing. In other words, when the high priest would go in behind the veil, oh, he was going into the Shekinah glory presence of God as it hovered above this little tabernacle, but there was no way he had access into the throne room of God in heaven because all he had was animal blood, and it could not remove sin. It merely covered it. Okay, now can we go to the next verse? Verse 8. No, verse 9, I'm sorry. All of this was a figure, a type, a picture. All of this was a figure for the time then present, animal sacrifices, temple worship, in which were offered both gifts and sacrifices that could not make him who did the service perfect or whole or complete, as pertaining to the conscience. Animal blood could not do it. Now, isn't it amazing? I'm thinking of it just as I've been teaching in the last 5 minutes. Isn't it amazing that Israel did not lose the temple until after Christ was crucified, buried, and risen from the dead? I'd never thought of it really before. Isn't it amazing? Those Romans could have just as well destroyed Jerusalem and the temple before all that was finished. My goodness, they were fighting the Jews for 100 years before Christ came. But oh, God in his sovereignty made sure that that temple worship kept on going until the finished work of the cross was accomplished. Because you see, otherwise, there would have been a time in there where the Jews had no way of approach. If the cross hadn't been completed, and if the temple was gone, there would have been nothing. But God made sure that they could keep on with that temple worship. They could still bring their sacrifices. Remember, though, there was a dead religion, and not many of them were true believers anymore, but there were a few. But God in his sovereignty made everything fit that after the work of the cross was completed, the temple could be destroyed. And that's why Paul can write in here that everything pertaining to the law is like an old, worn-out garment that you can fold up and lay it aside. How it all fits historically as well as biblically. All right. Now then, verse 10. All of these things of tabernacle worship stood only, that's all, it's as far as it could go, in meats and drinks and diverse washings and carnal or fleshly or earthly ordinances imposed on them, that is on Israel, until, there's your time word, when? The time of Reformation or setting everything straight. In other words, again, they stayed under this old system of tabernacle, animal, sacrificial worship until that work of the cross was consummated, and then all of this could fade away. It was now useless. Counts for nothing. And that's the whole purpose of this letter to the Hebrews. All right, now let's look at verse 10 carefully for the minutes that are left. All of this worship service, all of this daily operation of the priests, the yearly practice of the Day of Atonement, was all just simply a ritual of meats and drinks. In other words, there were drink offerings that were poured out, the animal sacrifices, and the burnt offerings, and so forth. And then the next one that's real interesting, diverse what? Washings. A lot of people don't want to hear this. But what do you suppose the word washing is in the Greek? You better write this in your margin. It's baptismo. Baptismo. In other words, along with all this sacrificial worship, they had baptisms, as we would call it. But they didn't call it baptism in the Old Testament. What'd they call it? Washing. Now, goodness, I don't have to tell you that. Let me go. Now I've got 2 minutes is all. Oh, my goodness. Let's come back to Leviticus. Exodus, Leviticus, chapter 8. Just one verse. That's all we're going to have time for. And this is preparation for the priesthood. But not only was it when they prepared for the priesthood, it was every day as they got ready to do this daily ministration. Whoever happened to be the priest's turn for that particular day, how did they have to start? Wash, wash, wash in water. All right, Leviticus 8, verse 6. And Moses brought Aaron and his sons and washed them with water. Now, if that would have been in the Greek, it would have said he baptized them in water. That's really what it says. And so the whole religion of Judaism was based on wash, wash, wash. And so when we come to John the Baptist and he begins baptizing in the River Jordan, where the Jews all shook up and said, what in the world is all this? Nah, nothing new. They'd been used to it for 1,500 years.
Thank you for watching Through the Bible with Les Felding. Through the Bible is a partner-supported ministry. If this program has been a help to your study of the Scriptures and you'd like to see others enjoy the teaching, your support would be greatly appreciated. Write to us at Les Feldick Ministries, Route 1, Box 760, Kinta, Oklahoma, 74552. Or call 1-800-369-7856. Remember, all programs are available in printed form, audio cassette, and videotape. Be sure to tune in next time to Through the Bible.